Media News for all races, connecting to the world. Media News for all races, connecting to the world.
From Abuja, Nigeria's capital territory, this is Around News Live.
This is NBN Network Media News for all races, connecting to the world.
Hello and welcome. Tonight, federal government moves to revolutionize the nation's trade. The president inaugurates steering committee to implement the national single window project, among other things, fast track cargo clearance at the ports. International Monetary Fund IMF upgrades Nigeria's growth forecast to 3.3% from 3.2% in 2024. The ongoing spring meetings in Washington, D.C., we have our correspondent there to bring us up to speed with a global dialogue. And federal government unveils 2024 annual flood outlook, says parts of 148 local government areas in 31 states of the Federation at risk of high flood. On business news tonight, Nigeria's foreign exchange reserves shrank by nearly $2 billion within 1 month, marking the lowest level in over 6 years.
On sports news tonight, Olympic torch lit in the traditional ceremony for the Paris 2024 Games in Olympia, the birthplace of the ancient games.
From Abuja, the nation's capital, members of the academic staff of Unity Colleges besieged the Ministry of Education in Abuja in protest over what they describe as non-payment of their 3-year salary by the federal government.
And in international news from London, Israel is calling for sanctions to be imposed on Iran's missile project after it launched an unprecedented attack on its territory.
Is ramping up measures towards placing the nation's trade activities on a new height. This comes as the president has inaugurated a steering committee for the implementation of the National Single Window Project. This initiative is aimed at providing a comprehensive trade facilitation system in Nigeria and ensuring faster cargo clearance at the nation's ports. As State House correspondent Empress Simon reports, that President Bola Tinubu has described the project as a game changer.
It's the president's first official engagement after the Eid al-Fitr holidays, and his attention is on addressing the challenges within Nigeria's business environment. To ensure smooth trade facilitation in the country, the Tinubu administration initiated the National Single Window Project, which seeks to address the bottlenecks and corruption evident in the country's trade system and to also facilitate the clearance of cargo at the ports. The president is here to inaugurate the Implementation Steering Committee, comprising the Nigeria Customs Service, the Federal Ministry of Finance, and the Federal Inland Revenue Service, among other agencies.
This initiative will serve as a catalyst for achieving an average GDP growth rate of 7% annually, propelling Nigeria to a new height of prosperity. Paperless trade alone is projected to bring an annual economic benefit of around $2.7 billion USD, a testament to the transformative power of this initiative.
President Tinubu believes the policy will also enhance Nigeria's trade relations with other African countries while also boosting revenue generation.
We cannot afford to lose an estimated $4 billion in US dollars annually to red tape, bureaucracy, delays, and corruption at our ports. The national single window where these issues headlong. Preventing revenue leakage and facilitating effective trade by doing so, will we create a more transparent, secure, and business-friendly environment that will attract investment and support economic growth.
From the Council Chamber, members of the committee briefed State House correspondents at the Press Gallery, where the Controller General of the Nigeria Customs Service highlights steps being taken towards the reopening of Nigeria's land borders.
In terms of opening the land borders, consultations are already in progress. Some of them at very high level. Over the last weekend, I had an interaction with my colleagues in Benin Republic. Earlier, I've gone to our borders in Niger Republic. We are looking at the issues that led to the closures of the border in the first instance.
The president urges members of the implementation steering committee to bring their expertise to bear in charting a new landscape for Nigeria's trade environment. From the presidential villa, Empress Simon.
And outside the shores of Nigeria, the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, reviewed its projection of economic growth for Nigeria for the year 2024 to 3.3%, coming up from the earlier projection of 3.2%. Speaking during the release of the World Economic Outlook of the ongoing IMF and World Bank spring meetings in Washington, D.C., the director of the research department of the fund, Pierre Olivier, also projected a downward trend in the nation's inflation rate to 23% later in the year and 18% in 2026. Our correspondent Sarah Achinogo reports from Washington, D.C.
To commence the spring meeting, officials of the International Monetary Fund are briefing journalists on the World Economic Outlook.
He's the economic counselor and the director.
First, the officials take a look at how developed economies are faring under the current economic climate vis-a-vis the impact on developing countries such as Nigeria.
You know, having a hard time sort of.
At the end, they make recommendations on how to get it right moving forward.
Inflation continues to come down. Median inflation will decline from 4% at the end of last year to 2.8% by the end of this year, and 2.4% at the end of 2025, and most indicators continue to point to a soft landing. A resilient growth and rapid disinflation are consistent with favorable supplies developments, including the fading of energy price shocks and a striking rebound in labor supply, supported by strong immigration in many advanced economies.
It's then time for question and answers. For Nigeria, the IMF appreciates recent interventions by the government, which it says will bring down inflation.
Growth in Nigeria, steady, but actually rising this year, from 2.9% last year to 3.3% this year. We've seen an expansion from the recovery in the oil sector with a better security situation and also improved agriculture. Benefiting from the better weather conditions and the introduction of dry season farming. So there's a broad-based increase also in the financial sector and the IT sector. Inflation, yes, it has increased. Part of this reflects the reforms, the exchange rate, and it's passed through into other goods, from imports to other goods. So this explains also why we revised up our inflation projection for this year to 26%.
At another meeting tagged Understanding Sovereign Debt in Africa, IMF is advocating a legal and legislative framework that will compel governments in the African region to be transparent with their debt data.
It has shown real leadership.
On Monday, the National Bureau of Statistics puts the nation's inflation rate for March at 33.2%. However, the International Monetary Fund is seeing a decline in the rates later in the year. This is just as the fund expresses confidence that fiscal and monetary policies are expected to impact the life of the people soon. From Washington, D.C.,
meanwhile, with the kickoff of the IMF and the World Bank meetings in Washington, D.C., debt and climate finance is back on the agenda. Nigeria's delegation is being led by the Minister of Finance, Mr. Wale Edu, and earlier he spoke with our London correspondent, Juliana Olayinka, about what to expect in the coming days.
Nigeria has to be at the table. Nigeria has to have its voice heard as a as an important country, not just in Africa, but in the world, given the size, the population, the resource endowment of the country, and of course, it is one of the largest democracies in the world, which is also a very important factor. It gives us an opportunity on the world stage, in front of the most important financial decision makers, and of course, the whole world is watching. The private sector in particular takes their signals from some of the conversations that go on. And it's an opportunity to showcase the achievements of the macroeconomic reform process of President Bola Ahmed Tinubu. It's an opportunity to see what has been done so far and also to indicate the direction of travel in which we are going and give people an indication of where things are likely to go next. And of course, although it's early days yet, it is a success story in the sense that the president set out, first of all, to stabilize the economy that he met, which was one, as we know, that was very lopsided. It was one that the financial situation was unsustainable. The fuel subsidy spending generally was way out of line with the revenues. And as we have seen, particularly in terms of what the central bank has done in stabilizing the exchange rate, together with the help of the rest of the economic team, the security network also came in to play an important role in removing some of the wrongdoing and some of the illegality that also was putting pressure on the exchange rate. And of course, on the fiscal side, on the government side, on the government revenue spending spending side, we took a leaf from what central bank indicated and have helped to raise interest rates to a level where it would be able to attract foreign exchange liquidity that has stabilized the foreign exchange rate, or in fact reversed its free fall, is the best way to put it.
In other stories now, the Minister of Water Resources and Sanitation, Professor Joseph Utsev, says that part of the 148 local government areas in 31 states of the Federation fall within the high flood risk areas. He said this during the public presentation of the 2024 Annual Flood Outlook for Nigeria at the Nigeria Hydrological Services Agency in Abuja. Meanwhile, at a separate event, the Minister of Agriculture and Food Security, Mr. Abubakar Kyari, asked farmers across the country to take advantage of the seasonal prediction of the Nigeria Meteorological Agency to increase agricultural produce in the country.
This is a presentation of the 2024 Annual Flood Outlook by the Nigeria Hydrological Services Agency, with the theme promoting the use of data analytics and modeling for flood risk assessments and food security. In attendance is the Minister of Water Resources and Sanitation and the Minister of State, Directors General of NIMET, Nigeria Hydrological Services Agency, amongst others. The The main purpose of the meeting is the unveiling of the states prone to flooding and possible preventions.
The focus is rather on prevention and mitigation of possible flood disasters through increasing its visibility on the part of the populace and advocating that they take appropriate preventive, adaptive, and mitigative measures and encouraging the citizens to comply with environmental guidelines and town planning regulations.
The high flood risk states are Adamawa, Akwa Ibom, Anambra, Bauchi, Bayelsa, Benue, Borno, Cross River, Delta, Ebonyi, Edo, Imo, Jigawa, Kaduna, Kano, Katsina, Kebbi, Kogi, Kwara, Lagos, Nasarawa, Niger, Ogun, Ondo, Osun, Oyo, Plateau, Rivers, Sokoto, Taraba, and Yobe states.
Letters and annual flood outlook publications with maps have been dispatched to the governors, while the exact local governments to be affected in each state and the expected level of flood are detailed out accordingly.
Meanwhile, the Minister of Agriculture and Food Security, Mr. Abubakar Kyari, is urging farmers across the country to take advantage of the seasonal predictions.
Regrettably, there have been farming seasons in Nigeria when farmers did not take advantage of the institutional advice from NIMET and on their own misread the rainfall pattern, only to face dry spells that invariably ruin their crops and livelihoods.
For all intents and purposes, the federal government is using this platform to provide early flooding warning information to the generality of Nigerians to mitigate the impact of the floods.
In part two after the break, Governor Dikko Rada of Katsina State vows continued onslaughts against terrorists in the state. A state's task force committee clamps down on petrol stations for allegedly selling fuel to insurgents. Please stay with us.
Network Media, news for all races, connecting you to the world.
Welcome back. If you've just joined us, you're watching a reminder of our top stories. Federal government moves to revolutionize the nation's trade. The president inaugurates committee to implement the national single window project to, among other things, fast track cargo clearance at the ports. International Monetary Fund IMF upgrades Nigeria's growth forecast to 3.3% from 3.2% in 2024. At the ongoing spring meetings in Washington, we have our correspondent there bringing us up to speed with a global dialogue. A federal government unveils 2024 annual flood outlooks as parts of 148 local government areas in 31 states of the Federation at risk of high flood. Israel is calling for sanctions to be imposed on Iran's missile project after it launched an unprecedented attack on its territory. To security matters, the governor, Dikko Rada of Katsina State, has pledged to continue to support the conventional security agencies in the state on their onslaught against terrorists. The governor made this commitment during a launch of 10 armored personnel vehicles for the joint operations across the 8 frontline local government areas of Katsina State. He explained that the last 7 months, a lot has been achieved since the beginning of the joint operation by the police, the army, and the community watch call.
I have walked the talk by providing all the necessary equipments needed to Katsina Community Watch as well as the joint operation led by the police. You know, this insecurity issue is an issue that we have inherited, and as an issue that has come and become a hot burner during our campaign activities. And we have promised the people of Katsina State of our willingness to provide all the necessary skills, tactics, and strategies to provide the necessary security in our place. And we thank God The Katsina Community Watch has been in operation for about 7 months now. And we were very thankful to Almighty Allah to the achievements so far recorded. We cannot claim a total elimination of banditry and criminality in my state, but we want to assure people that a lot has been achieved from the beginning of the operation, a joint operation between the Katsina Community Watch and the Nigerian police with the military. In fact, a lot of things have been achieved, but we are still having challenges in some of these frontline local governments.
While at least 10 suspects have been arrested by the Katsina State Task Force Committee on Food Security for allegedly selling fuel to insurgents in the forest. In an operation conducted across various fuel stations in the state capital, the chairman of the task force, Jabiru Tsuari, said that 3 petrol stations have so far been sealed and culprits have been apprehended. He says this is part of the government's determination to eradicate insurgents and their collaborators across the state. Meanwhile, lawmakers from the People's Democratic Party in the House of Representatives say that they are giving a 3-month ultimatum to President Tinubu administration to address the security situation in the country. The lawmakers, led by the minority leader of the House of Representatives, Kingsley Chinda, reached this resolution after a closed-door meeting at the National Assembly. Meanwhile, the caucus insists the PDP in the House of Representatives remains united, despite calls by some other PDP lawmakers for the resignation of the acting national chairman of the party.
The government is therefore called upon to immediately take steps to ensure that the security situation in the country is normalized. And the caucus have also given 3 months ultimatum for government to normalize the security situation in our country. After 3 months, the caucus will take further steps to sensitize and mobilize Nigerians to perhaps take their security into their hands. The House of Representatives caucus also agreed to call on all party caucuses, the Board of Trustees, National Executive Committee and the National Working Committee of the party to embark on reconciliatory measures with a view to resolve all litigations that are pending and that has hindered the party in any way whatsoever from having a substantive national chair. We call on our leaders of the People's Democratic Party, to continue to demonstrate unconditional loyalty to the party and ensure that the party is moved to her pride of place where she enjoyed the position of the largest party in Africa and to take back the Aso Villa, which is actually supposed to be our birthright.
Away from security matters now, people of Okuta Ibeku community in Umuahia, North local government area of Abia State, have staged a peaceful protest over the death of their kinsman, an Air Force cadet, Emmanuel Onyemereche, who allegedly drowned in a swimming pool at Dangreet Hotel last week Tuesday. Carrying placards with different inscriptions, the protesters, comprising men, women and youths, gathered at the government house in Umuahia's front gate after marching through the busy streets. Their grief protesters are appealing to Governor Alex Oti to grant them justice by ensuring the matter is not swept under the carpet. The special advisor to the governor on security expressed concern over the sad incident, assuring the people that investigation will be thoroughly carried out to unravel the circumstances.
We are here today to make known to the government over the death of our brother, who is an Air Force officer to be decorated by July this year. The information we got last week was that he came around during Easter period to pay his family a visit. And on Tuesday last week, a friend took him to Dangreet Hotels, where we got information that he was drowned in the pool. And we are here to present
we will take measures to brief His Excellency, the Executive Governor of Abia State, on the matter. Whatever has happened, has happened. We leave it for God, but investigations will be carried out to ensure that if there are perpetrators of this act, it will be unraveled and justice will be seen to be done.
We have more for you on the news at 10 as we head over to our Abuja studios now, where Gloria Umezoke is standing by to give us more. Hello, Gloria.
Many thanks, Anne. Well, here in Abuja, we turn attention now to education matters. The academic staff of Unity Colleges across the country are protesting what they claim is the non-payment of 3 years' salary owed by the federal government. The teachers who besieged the Federal Ministry of Education in Abuja are demanding an expeditious look into their predicament and prompt resolution of the matter. Our correspondent, Benny Ock, reports.
This gathering advocates the Ministry of Education comprises academic staff from the 110 Unity schools across the country. The teacher says they are here to protest the non-payment of a 3-year salary arrears owed by the federal government.
The major reason for being here was as a result of the interview our Honorable Minister, Professor Tayo Maman, had on Channels TV, where he was asked as regards our salary arrears, and he noted that he wasn't aware. So we came today to actually inform him.
The Minister of State for Education, Mr. Yusuf Sununu, came out to address the disgruntled teachers.
And we have agreed and concluded today is going to be a meeting day whereby we are going to listen to you, get to know all the problems, and then we set a machinery to address the issue. But unfortunately, while we are in our office, waiting for the leadership to come so that we can have a very good potential discussion that will resolve your problems. The next thing we had it was there was demonstration outside the ministry.
He then called for a closed meeting with the elected representatives of the protesting teachers.
Please allow us to sit down with your leadership. Let them make our presentation. We tell them the way forward we are going to follow, and we set a motion to ensure that all issues are addressed.
Coming out of a closed-door meeting with the minister and various stakeholders, a representative of the teachers speaks on the outcome.
The meeting was a fruitful one, and resolutions from the meeting states categorically that between now and next week, a committee will be set up for a meeting that will give us a time frame when this process will be concluded comprehensively. So we are happy to note, and we want to thank our Honorable Minister for State and our Honorable Minister of Education for giving us audience and for responding to our cry, as well as the Permanent Secretary of Education and the other directors. We want to thank them for giving us a listening ear, responding to our cries, and giving us a time frame.
The group says its members are optimistic that there will be a performance of the agreement and recommendations this time around. Benny Ock.
Meanwhile, in Anambra State, Governor Chukwuma Soludo has distributed 2,000 brand new laptops to primary school head teachers and principals of public schools across the state. Governor Soludo, who made the presentation at the International Conference Center, OCA, explained that the distribution aligns perfectly with his vision of ensuring the full digitization of all sectors of the state economy, as well as prioritizing teaching and teachers in the state.
The Anambra State International Convention Center comes alive with the presence of head teachers and principals of public schools in the state for the distribution of laptops procured by the state government for them. The laptop distribution has positive implications, as the chairman of the Anambra State Universal Basic Education Board says the project is to bring about a digital revolution in the education sector, while the chairman of the Post Primary Schools Service Commission notes that it's a promise kept by the governor.
In
Commissioner for Education points out the governor's interest in the quality of education in the state.
He is particularly concerned about the quality of teachers and the quality of teaching in Anambra State. And he went through this Twitter examination to 25,000 teachers in Anambra.
An excited Governor Soludo appreciates the teachers and school administrators for the good work they are doing and assures of making the education sector a priority in the state.
We prioritize you, our education. We prioritize our future. And that's why we're committing the resources that we're doing. We're committing several of our schools to become smart schools. Efficiencies in our primary schools, and then you have the infrastructure in those. We're also building what I call durable partnerships for our educational system.
Unveiling the laptops for onward distribution, the governor announces the launch of free public Wi-Fi in some strategic places, which will be scaled up to schools to begin smart education and the creation of the digital tribe.
The goal is to create the digital tribe, and it all begins now. Thank you very much to the glory of God. We are one day standing this triple take.
Please, a round of applause. Put your hands together.
The high point of the ceremony was the distribution of the laptops to head teachers and principals, as well as solidarity chants by the beneficiaries, as hopes are high in anticipation of the effects this new input will bring to the state.
But still ahead on the news at 10, Nigeria's foreign exchange reserves shrink by nearly $2 billion within 1 month, marking the lowest level in over 6 years. That's some business news. Let's join us again.
NBN Network Media, news for all races, connecting you to the world.
Welcome back. You're still watching the news at 10. Away from education, the Minister of the Federal Capital Territory, Mr. Nelson Wike, says the upkeep and sanitation of satellite towns and the FCT is a major fraud in the system because the areas are mostly abandoned. Mr. Wike said this during the inauguration of the coordinator of the Satellite Town Developments Department, Mr. Abdulkadir Zulukarfi, at his office in Abuja. He warned the newly inaugurated coordinator against sabotage of the key performance indicators of his administration.
In the cleaning of the satellite town, let me just say clearly, that would be a fraud. That would be a lot of fraud. Because, you know, you know, when I clean the end of the month,
has declared April the 7th of every year as National Police Day. President Bola Tinubu made the declaration through the Vice President Kashim Shettima at the Maiden Award and Commendations event organized by the Nigeria Police Force. He says the current administration is determined to reform the Nigeria police force in line with the president's renewed hope agenda of ensuring the security of lives and property of citizens.
Please, we want to invite the chaplain.
Excellent service, gallantry efforts, self-sacrifice. These virtues award the Nigerian Police Force is celebrating at this maiden police award and commendations event in Abuja.
Especially all of the heads of the other agencies.
Vice President Kashim Shatiba represents President Bola Tinubu at the occasion.
It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you very much.
Prominent Nigerians, including the President of the Senate, Senator Godswill Akpabio, are also in attendance. Men and officers of the Nigerian police are often criticized for their alleged unprofessional conduct. But tonight, its leadership says there are still officers who are holding the flag of the force high up.
This ceremony serves as a poignant reminder that the efforts of our officers are both seen and valued. Let this also serve as a reassurance that the leadership of the force is deeply committed to the well-being of all members of the force, as well as improved service delivery.
While commending the Nigerian police for its role in maintaining law and order, guests, however, urged the force to pay more attention to the welfare of its personnel and ensure those found to be complicit in discharging their duties are punished.
As we honor the good officers, let us weed out the bad officers amongst you, because the chain is as strong as its weakest link.
Their words cut across various areas of policing, such as the Police Command Commissioner of the Year, Investigator of the Year, Police Public Relations Officer of the Year, Crime and Cybercrime Busters of the Year, among others.
Commissioner of Police, River State Command, CP, Olatunji Rewan District.
Posthumous awards and funds are also presented to families of those who died in the line of duty.
Back home with the sum of 1 million naira each of the families. Please put your hands together for them.
Police Officer of the Year goes to the DPO of the Year.
Then comes the award for the Police Officer of the Year.
It takes into consideration operational efficiency, integrity, resilience, Shabali.
When it's time for his remarks, Vice President Kashim Shatiba makes no delay in unfolding President Bola Tinubu's plan towards reforming the Nigerian police.
We are upgrading your equipment and technology to enhance operational effectiveness and efficiency. This includes acquiring fit for purpose equipment, weapons, ammunition, and armored carriers to provide cover and protection for officers in combat situations. The 7th of April is hereby declared National Police Day in Nigeria.
Well, that's it from the nation's capital. It's back to you, Anne, for more on the news at 10.
Thank you, Gloria. Over 300,000 kilograms of 40,000 liters of illicit substances seized from various parts of Lagos and Ogun states have been destroyed by the National Drug Law Enforcement Agency, the NDLEA. The heap of illicit substances was publicly set ablaze at the Badagry area of Lagos in the presence of the chairman and chief executive officer of the agency, Brigadier General Mohammed Buba Marwa, and other top officials of the agency. Brigadier General Marwa said the open destruction of the seized illicit drugs followed court orders as he called for more public support for ongoing efforts by the NDLEA and other stakeholders to curb the menace of substance abuse and illicit drug trafficking in Nigeria. The Nigerian Civil Aviation Authority has suspended the permit for non-commercial flights of three operators in a bid to sanitize the general aviation sector. And this is coming on the heels of an earlier warning from the NCAA to holders of the PNCF against the engaging of carriage of passenger cargo or mail for hire and reward. According to the acting director general of the NCAA, the three private operators suspended are in violation of the annexure provision of their PNCF and Part 9114 of the Nigeria Civil Aviation Regulations 2023.
Back in November 2023, the use of private jets for commercial purposes had caught the attention of the Honorable Minister of Aviation and Aerospace Development, Festus Keamo, SAM. who issued marching orders for the cessation of such acts. Subsequently, in March 2024, the NCA had issued a stern warning to holders of the permit for non-commercial flights, PNCF, against engaging the carriage of passengers, cargo, or mail for hire in the world. The authority had also deployed its official to monitor activities of private jet terminals across the airports in Nigeria. As a consequence of this heightened surveillance, no fewer than three private operators have been found to be in violation of the annexure provision of their PNCF and Part 9114 of the Nigerian Civil Aviation Regulations. In line with our zero tolerance for violation of regulations, the authority has suspended the PNCF of these operators. To further sanitize the general aviation sector, I have directed that a re-evaluation of all holders of PNCF be carried out on or before the 19th of April 2024 to ascertain compliance with regulatory requirements.
Let's delve into the world of business. Willie Bonk is standing by.
This is NBN Network Media, news for all races, connecting you to the world.
Reserves have taken a sharp hit, dropping by about $1.84 billion in just 26 days as the Central Bank of Nigeria, CBN, intensifies efforts to stabilize the Naira. As at April the 12th, data from the CBN reveals reserves standing at $32.61 billion, a significant decline from the $34.45 billion recorded on March the 18th this year. Analysts believe the decline can be attributed to CBN's active interventions in the FX market to bolster the Naira. This downturn marks the lowest reserves level since September 29, 2017, when reserves were at $32.49 billion. Now, Stanbic IBTC is hoping to raise 350 billion Naira infrastructure fund through the Securities and Exchange Commission to support its customers in their desire to upscale investment and solve the problem in the power and energy sectors. The Chief Executive Officer of the bank, Bimola Shogunle, discloses during the Stanbic IBTC Energy and Infrastructure Breakfast session in Lagos. The gathering seeks to stimulate real thought and spur action towards a more sustainable and efficient future in Nigeria's energy and infrastructure domain.
Despite having one of the largest crude oil and gas reserves in the world, Nigeria's average daily crude oil production is below expectation, and domestic power supply continues to face challenges such as inadequate generation capacity, inadequate and aging transmission and distribution infrastructure. It is against this backdrop that the Stanbic IBTC Energy and Infrastructure Breakfast Session is convened. While identifying microeconomic issues affecting the industry, the keynote speakers offer strategies for meeting Nigeria's energy demand in 2024 and beyond.
There's no point people sitting on assets if they don't have the capacity or the will to make them work. These assets should be given to people who have the capacity, who have the will, who have the financial resources to produce them.
What the country has as the only viable option to bridge the electricity gap is through distributed generation, distributed access.
For Stanbic IBTC, the Infrastructure Fund program is one of its contributions towards solving the problem of power and energy.
We've already come back to the Securities and Exchange Commission for Stanbic IBTC Infrastructure Fund 2. Do you know the size? 350 billion naira. Why are we running up and down? Is to be able to solve these challenges on behalf of our customers so that Nigeria can grow.
One of the participants explains the role of technology in optimizing and enhancing operations in the energy sector.
Because of the various requirements to drill the well,
to measure the properties of the formation that will determine what kind of oil or gas that we have. The process of extracting that, bringing it to surface, all of the pipelines, you need technology along that.
We all know that one of the biggest challenges this country has is power, energy. Okay? And organizing sessions like this is our little contribution towards bridging that gap.
The Stanbic IBTC Energy and Infrastructure Breakfast Session is the second in the series. The gathering also aims to foster new business relationships, facilitate networking opportunities, and build a vibrant community of professionals within the value chain.
Now, still in the energy space, Dangote Petroleum Refinery has slashed the price of diesel from 1,200 to 1,000 naira per liter, following a 30% reduction just 3 weeks ago. The move aims to alleviate economic strain and tackle high inflation rates in Nigeria, promising widespread benefits across industries. This bold initiative underscores the refinery's commitment to driving positive economic change, offering relief to businesses and consumers alike. Now it's still bleeding at the NGX as the equities markets benchmark index loses a crucial level in today's trading session. Dominic Iwuwu tells us more.
Hello and welcome to the Stock Market Report. I'm Dominic Iwuwu. It's another day and another red close for the local bourse as profit taking intensifies with the all share index hanging by a thread over the 100,000 points, further declining by 1.04%, with a market capitalization of 56.96 trillion naira. The banking counter is down again by over 5%, while the consumer goods fell further by 1.02%, and the oil and gas sector remains unchanged. Most sectors that we track are still down, so the second trading day of the week, and the market sustains negative trend, just 3 days left for the week. Let's hope the bull makes an appearance, but for today, it is bearish.
Thank you, Dominic. Now let's check out the performance of other major stock markets around the world.
BN Network Media, news for all races, connecting you to the world.
Thank you, Will. Worried about war and its impact on Iran's already failing economy, a significant portion of Iranians oppose what they see as the reckless adventurism of the country's elite Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, which fired more than 300 drones and missiles on Saturday night. Hey, Simon Pusey with more international news and around the world.
This is NBN Network Media, news for all races, connecting you to the world.
Welcome to the channel's studios here in London with your international news around the world in five. Israel is calling for sanctions to be imposed on Iran's missile project after it launched an unprecedented attack on its territory. A wave of missiles and drones were fired from Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Yemen on Saturday, with most being downed by Israel and its allies. Israel's military chief of staff has said the attack will not go unanswered. Tehran says the attack was retaliation for the presumed Israeli airstrike on its consulate in Syria on April the 1st, in which 13 people were killed. Since the Israel-Gaza war erupted 6 months ago, Israel has ramped up its targeting of Iran over its funding and arming of Hamas. Denmark's historic Old Stock Exchange building in the centre of Copenhagen has been engulfed by fire. 17th century Boston is one of the city's oldest buildings, and onlookers gasp as its iconic spire collapsed in flames. Everyone inside the building was able to leave, and people rushed to rescue some of its historic paintings. Culture Minister Jakob Engel-Schmidt said 400 years of Danish cultural heritage had gone up in flames. The building, dating back to 1625, is a stone's throw from Denmark's parliament, the Folketing, and the royal palace, Christiansborg. Australian police have declared Monday's stabbing at a Sydney church as a religiously motivated terrorist attack. A 16-year-old boy was arrested after a bishop, a priest, and churchgoers were attacked during Mass at the Assyrian Christ of the Good Shepherd Church. At least four people suffered non-life-threatening injuries, police say. The attacker was also hurt. The incident was captured on church live stream and quickly triggered unrest in the suburb of Wakeley.
I declared that it was a terrorist incident. Strike Force Katrina has been established to investigate that side of the events last night.
There is no such thing in Australia in taking the law into your own hands. It doesn't exist. That's for several reasons. Firstly, you'll be met by the full force of the law if there's any attempt for tit-for-tat violence in Sydney over the coming days.
At least 39 people have been killed in Pakistan after days of unusually heavy rains battered the country's southwest. Some of those killed were farmers struck by lightning while harvesting wheat. Images online show swathes of farmland engulfed by rainwater. Flash floods have also disrupted power supplies and transportation networks. Pakistan has experienced an increase in extreme weather events as it grapples with the impacts of climate change. A colossal amount of water is moving towards the Russian city of Kurgan, the region's governor has said. Vadim Shumkov said that the swollen Tobol River and its tributaries had produced water levels twice those of the last major flood in 1994. Floods over the past 2 weeks have forced evacuations of tens of thousands of people from northern Kazakhstan and bordering areas of Russia. Waters are expected to rise as high as 36 feet above normal. Myanmar resistance fighters have burned the flag used by the military government and raised their own banner at a newly captured army base, as a senior rebel commander vowed they would hold the strategic area near the Thai border. Celebrations by fighters linked to the armed ethnic Karen National Union came less than a week after the capture of Miawadi, a key trading town on Thailand's western border. And a scuffle erupted in Georgia's parliament as the leader of the opposition punched an MP. MP Mamuka Umdinadze was speaking when opposition leader Aleko Elisashvili punched him during a debate over a controversial law. There was then a melee involving dozens of lawmakers. Critics say the foreign influence bill is inspired by authoritarian laws neighboring Russia uses to crush dissent. Thousands of protesters demonstrated in the Georgian capital Tbilisi on Monday, demanding the withdrawal of the bill. And that's your international news around the world in five.
Media news for all races, connecting to the world.
From Abuja, Nigeria's capital territory, this is Around News Live.
This is NBN Network Media news for all races, connecting to the world.